out of your seat in 10 seconds. You will be visited by a spirit. A spirit that you would not know was there if you had been in your seat. The start of this experience. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Charles Elmore. I think is a very fascinating and awesome film to watch. And a very special and unique and special one night only kind of experience. Tonight, Circle has a very special screening of HAXAN in store for you. It is accompanied by a live, improvised oftentimes, but mostly composed and well-written improvised, is that a word? Anyways, by Dustin Howard. Dustin, stand up. Guide through this amazing journey. Now, this is going to be played live, and we've all been to live shows where there's a bit of background video elements, and sometimes if the sync slips, a little bit of time change, speed up, you might feel a little bit, when that 20 milligrams hits, if you feel a bit of a tempo change, you know you're in the right space. If you feel a little bit something else, that's maybe HAXAN. HAXAN is a pretty amazing film. It's 102 years old, this movie. On like the Today Show for surviving this long. But it is a phenomenal, influential film and work of silent era cinema that is as influential as anything from Eisenstein or any of the great pioneers and iterative starters of this sort of cinematic language that we now call or watch often in cinema. It was made by Danish filmmaker Ben Christensen, who was of a bit of privileged background and wanted to be a doctor and we all do, matriculating into the set life, where he became a film director and inherited a studio. And HAXAN is his third film, and it's his, I think, most ambitious. It was, at the time, and I think still, because I don't think they make silent era films anymore, but it is the most expensive produced Scandinavian silent film era of its creation. It was made for 1.2 kroner, which I don't know how much that is, because I haven't read Girl with the Dragon Tattoo in a while. It's interesting about this film because how many of you have seen HAXAN? Witchcraft Through the Ages. Great. So a few of us, and there's a bunch of varieties of this movie out there. There's an original cut with a very whimsical, oftentimes antagonistically in competition soundtrack from a bunch of needle drops of the classical era. And there's also a newer version from the 60s, I think around 67, 68. A filmmaker did a bit of recutting with a jazz score and also a little bit of William S. Burroughs' spoken word, Dobrit. So I think that became the more popular kind of cult-driven version of this, and I think is a version of what we're kind of be watching tonight, including some of the William S. Burroughs stuff. Oh, sure. It's interesting because Christensen uses these reenactments of historical witch trials and witch hunts from the medieval era and was probably what would never have been a relevant way of treating sort of form of at the time what was considered female hysteria or modern progressive women just going about their own business, living life. But he wanted to throw light on the psychological causes of these witch trials that oftentimes were just simply rooted in these modern maladies of the time or psychic dips or drops in the human population that because of this sort of, I don't know, narrow-mindedness of the time, they just thought you were touched or possessed by a demon and you were mostly a woman, so they would just try to kill you, I guess. Lots changed since then, obviously. In Christensen's view, he saw that the medieval women and the early modern women of that era who were labeled witches and who suffered no manner of torture and death that could be described or depicted at the hands of men who were armed with the power of the church would be no different than the women of his era just being diagnosed with hysteria and, you know, diagnosed with that cozy, like, seaside convalescing that we've all been seeing lately. But more torturous, I guess. Although you watch this judging by the fact that if you recognize the very barrel-chested demon figure frequently, that's played by none other than the filmmaker himself. And so oftentimes in some of these scenes where they're reenacting these rituals and these sort of satanic temptations, it's often Christensen himself not just directing the scenes but also participating in it, which I think just goes to show, like all filmmakers, he's just one of those people that loves to enact a kind of cruel pleasure and forcing humans to reenact and be subjected to interesting tortures, all in the name of cinema, mind you. You know, you can look to this film as a very influential film on a lot of films even to this day. This film was being made around the same time as Eisenstein and Kudovkin were formalizing the Russian montage theory, which is, along with the Kuleshov effect, kind of the foundational pillar of what makes narrative and moving image cinema what it is today and the kind of art form that has become so enchanting to so many filmmakers. So many filmmakers that I think the list could be rolled out in a giant scroll, but just to name a few, this film has been influential to Robert Eggers, to Ari Aster, a couple Florida filmmakers around 1994 when they were trying to decide what to name the production company that they would make their indie lo-fi found footage horror film in the woods, called Blair Witch Project, decided to call their company HAXAN Films. You also see a lot of influence on films like The Exorcist, not to mention The Brood and Aversion. I don't think their influence is seen no stronger than around the same time Carl Theodore Dreyer had seen HAXAN and the powerful use of close-ups in this film that actually inspired him to incorporate close-ups into his filmmaking at the time, which he became synonymous for and has some of the most historically famous close-ups in cinema, like the close-up of Joan of Arc in The Passion of Joan of Arc, a film that a young Swedish filmmaker named Ingmar Bergman saw and then used heavily to make Cries and Whispers, which I think it's worth saying that HAXAN by way of Bergman is a pretty awesome kind of through line of this work. You know, as a fan of this movie, I love HAXAN. I love watching this. I love seeing the early formative techniques of cinema on display being made in some Danish studio by some crazy lunatic filmmaker, because I still see that today. Just like you see techniques like superimposition, film reversing in order to create a reverse effect, these are pioneering techniques at the time that now seem rote or old hat these days, but still filmmakers draw inspiration from them in some kind of incantatorial way, the way we revisit these films often in new and revisiting ways. In ways like tonight, where we experience it in a new way, where you're going to experience with a revived and revitalized eye and experience through both the sound journey Dustin throws us on, but also the visuals that Benjamin Christensen created that I think still to this day are influential, they are hypnotic, they are astonishing, and I'm excited about those of you who've seen it, rediscovering it, those of you who haven't, checking it out for the first time and seeing it. I'm going to close here in just a second, but I want to close with a few of the critical responses at the time because I think you'll understand the movie you're about to watch. Dave Kerr, a film critic for the Chicago Reader, wrote that in HAXAN, Christensen intended a serious study of witchcraft, which he diagnoses in an early pop Freud conclusion as female hysteria, but what he really has is a pretense for sadistic pornography. The film has acquired impact with age. Instead of seeming quaint, the nude scenes and scatological references now have a crumbly, sinister quality. They seem the survivals of ancient, unhealthy imaginations. That ancient, unhealthy imagination, I think, is still alive and kicking tonight in this screening. Another great quote by a critic at the time for Variety wrote in his review of HAXAN at the time, this is a full-throated praise, by the way, I endorse this praise. He said, wonderful though this picture is, it is absolutely unfit for public exhibition. Folks, I wholeheartedly want to welcome you. I want to thank Circle Cinema for putting this on. This is an amazing time to watch. It's holidays, so get in the holiday spirit. What better reason to celebrate the season than at the Church of Cinema, amongst your other churches of worship, et cetera. Anyways, I want to thank you all for joining us. Dustin's going to take it away from here. Thank you so much. One last quote. It said, the satanic perverted cruelty that blazes out of HAXAN. The cruelty we all know has stalked the ages like an evil, shaggy beast, the chimera of mankind. But when it is captured, let it be locked up in a cell, either in a prison or a madhouse,
Do not let it be presented with music by Wagner or Chopin to young men and women who have entered the enchanted world of a movie theater. I think Wagner and Chopin are safe tonight. Don't lower their hands. See you on the other side.
Them out and bar the door. Lock them out forevermore. Nook and cranny, window, door, seal them out forevermore. Curse go back, curse go back. Back with double fear and flack. Curse go back, curse go back.
Thank you.
circle, Almighty God was enthroned, surrounded by nine angelic choirs. And it was God who controlled the world machinery. In the bowels of the earth was hell and its eternal torments, one of which was to find yourself being put into a boiling cauldron. Here, one of the damned is thrown directly into the fire. Here's a demon giving one of the damned a drink of horrid brimstone liquid. This scene gives an accurate picture of the conceptions of the Middle Ages. Look at these two demons stoking the fire so energetically beneath the cauldron.
Thank you.
It's midnight in a little town in the Middle Ages. Solomon's book, Judges and Judgments. You can see these engravings showing the judges and witches carrying out their duties. To find out if the witch is guilty, she is made to undergo the water truth. Here the witch is tied up. Then they take her to the deepest spot. If she floats, she is burned at the stake. And if she sinks, the judges thank God for her innocence. You're now going to see a witch hunt during the period when the Pope had dispatched judges through all of Christendom, specialized in witch hunting. Thank you. possession must not exchange one for the gold.
We'll be right back.
hindered the arrest of a witch was considered an accomplice. Thus the fate of young Anna, Jesper Lorelien's wife, was settled. Only two members of Jesper Lorelien's unfortunate household now remain.
Thank you.
cutting up stake after stake and cleaning out all the witches in town, the judges move on to the next, bearing the good tidings. They do their work and go. Like a mental epidemic, the madness of witchcraft spreads wherever these judges settle down. In 2 centuries, 8 million victims were burned alive at the stake for the crime of witchcraft. The accounts given by the witches are so precise that they satisfy the most exacting judges. Thus, numerous women confessed that they had changed themselves into cats and at nightfall polluted the altar, while 2 demons in animal form kept watch at the church door. Some women were burned at the stake after being accused of bewitching conjugal beds by making knots. Each knot would prevent a pregnancy. It was the magic knot of impotence, the dreaded conjugal evil. With the help of witch's hair and a metallic cross, all the happiness of a home could be destroyed once and for all. Understand clearly the confessions of the witches. Take a look at the instruments of torture that were used. There's little doubt that any one of us would confess incredible things with the help of such arguments. French doctor, Paul Reynard, describes the way in which this very special collar was used. It is held by 4 tightly stretched cords. The wrists and ankles of the victim are fastened to 2 iron bars. A blazing basin is brought in. This engraving is entitled, After the Interrogation. Questioning, a light torture was used. The thumbscrew, for example. The majority of convents in the Middle Ages, fear of the devil reached hysteria. The nuns took to flagellation and to mortification. Sisters was afflicted with infernal visions, the whole convent would soon fall prey to this madness. Raving mystical lunacy, enigmatic and contagious madness, leading to excesses of sacrilegious and erotic behavior. In accounts which are still preserved, these women have told, with striking simplicity, how the devil penetrated the convent. God knows what horrible delusions these women went through before they were invaded by madness. They confessed in despair. We were provoked by the devil.
Thank you.
she remind us of the nun who, provoked by the devil, caused a revolution in the convent. This unfortunate woman does in her sleep that which, in waking state, she fears most of all. These states fall into the category of psychic illness we call hysteria today. Remember the witch who was visited by the devil at night? The hysteric nowadays is not visited by the devil, but sometimes by an artist, a fashionable religious teacher, or by a famous doctor who comes to disturb the peace of her dreams. Hysteric always asserts that her visitors entered through the window or by passing through the wall. Notice how this unconscious woman clings to the bed. Among the real sufferings of the hysteric, there are more than a few pretenses. Witches' naked body with spots in order to make it numb. In fact, the torturer often found insensitive and numb spots on the back of the accused.
Thank you.
laughing century. The god of the Middle Ages is no longer in his circle, surrounded by nine angelic choir. We no longer prostrate ourselves in agony in front of the pictures on church walls. The witch no longer rides to the Sabbath on her broomstick. But is not superstition still rife among us? Is there such a difference between the witch of yesteryear and the clairvoyant of today? We don't burn old women today, but aren't they wretched in a different way? And the hysterical woman, strange behavior, isn't she still something of an enigma to us? Nowadays, we confine such women to lunatic asylum, or if the woman be rich, into a modern clinic with her, and there the therapeutic shower has replaced the tortures of former times. But the enigma of the devil remains, and will no doubt remain unsolved until the death of the last man.
Getting into like a giallo film.
Yeah.
Which I was
really. I was watching something like that.